Everybody attending, first of all, a quick premise, this seminar should have been a joint seminar, so joint spoken seminar between Yekaterina Peritkova and myself, because we are both authors, but then Yekaterina could not make it today, so she apologized with everybody, and she's really sorry about that. I will try to make the best by myself on the presentation. Also because this was mostly her main idea and work for her dissertation. So to start, I'm going to tell you what the paper is about and what the seminar is going to cover. And then we will have a more long throughout path toward the argument that we laid down. So the idea is that we wanted to study how the diffusion emergence of artificial intelligence technologies are impacting one specific sector, which is the one of chip making, or if you want, the semiconductor industry. I'm going to tell you why this is important and why it is relevant and how it fits into a broader scope of studies, social science and economic studies of AI. First of all, a note, because you notice that the title of the paper is On the Basis of Brain rather than On the Basis of the Brain, but this is what in Italy we call a poetic license, because this is a quote from the book from the movies On the Basis of Sex, where the story of the judge, justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg is mentioned, and she somehow avoid that people are discriminated on the basis of sex. And here we are studying how the industry is changing and is discriminating its production on the basis of brain, in a sense of on the basis of the arrival of artificial intelligence or neural network inspired technology. So it was a sort of tiny tips, cute Easter egg inside the title. So let's start. And I'm an economist as a training. So the first thing that I want to do was to put in context what we are going to discuss in as a big preliminary into the landscape of the research trajectory in the economics of AI. Many of you are maybe not completely interested in the economics of AI, and there is more an engineering or industry attention to the issue, or a more hard science attention to the issue of the issues related to AI. However, from an economic point of view, there is a widespread attempt to study artificial intelligence technologies. Along different kind of topics, subtopics. And I'm going to tell you that because then it's clear why we focus on semiconductor and chip making. So the literature on the economics of AI is studying, first of all, if AI is a so-called general purpose technology. Some of you might have listened to the other seminar that we gave to the network on the idea that AI is or is not a general purpose technology, or what is called a large technical system. And so scholars are trying to understand the fundamental nature of artificial intelligence technologies, especially because this can give insights with respect to how AI can impact productivity, how it can change the logic of how innovation is conducted. So the very way in which as the AI 3SD network studies how the very kind of brute forcing approach to explore knowledge spaces can be affected by AI. Economists are also looking at how AI is having wide economic impact. And in this case, there is a huge conflation of concepts between artificial intelligence technologies and automation. So economists tend very much, and this is not a very nice methodological nor theoretical approach, to conflate and to confuse automation with AI. And a lot of studies are usually labeled as AI economics, are introducing some form of artificial intelligence into what are called growth models, or study of companies, strategies, and startup, or how AI can change or can affect the future of work, how it will impact gig labor, the gig economy, if you want, how it is creating monopsonies, so the situation in which there is huge labor supply and the labor demand is concentrated in a few actors, like the Amazon Mechanical Turk, if you want, while this labor has to let's say execute tasks in digital workspaces, in the cloud, and AI powered systems. And then there is a set of studies that look at how AI is impacting what is called the industrial organization, meaning how markets and firms react in their structure to the arrival, adoption, and deployment of AI technology. So the emergence of, for example, data marketplaces, the effect of data spillovers and the data elaboration on firm strategies and on market formation. What does the lowering the cost of prediction, which is one of the main impact of AI, means for the structure, for example, the vertical integration of industries, the networking of companies, and so on and so forth. And finally, economists are studying AI in as a tool, for example, in econometrics, how AI is, in particular, the use of machine learning is changing the way in which we conduct economic analysis. And very finally, there is a set of studies that try to map AI technology, like the adoption, which actors produce, which actor use them, which publications and in which fields AI keywords are studied, and so on and so forth. Now, this is all very interesting, and this is what the economists have been doing in the last, let's say, 4 to 5 years in the economics of AI. However, as both Ekaterina and myself are economists of innovation or economists of technological change, we realize that there is something missing in all that. So we needed a start. So first of all, as I told you, there is a very unclear and confusing conflating of AI with automation. Of course, you have a lot of robotic system that use AI, but you also have robotic system that do not use AI. You have disembodied AI that is not related to automation processes as process innovation without within workplaces, for example. And the fact that all the economists somehow jumped on the train of trying to understand if AI is the new general revolutionary path-breaking technology somehow made social sciences not to focus very much on which are the technological developments that artificial intelligence technologies are inducing in, let's say, technology-producing industries. There is interest on pricing of AI and how AI changing prices in markets or welfare implication. What is missing is a study on what we call the infrastructure of AI, namely how AI is changing the way in which hardware is produced. Why this is important, I will repeat that later on, but the point is that the hardware industry, and in particular the industry, the semiconductor industry, has been standing on a very well-defined, what we would call in the economics of technical change, technological trajectory. So a very specific way on how to organize production, innovation, and how to reduce the uncertainty regarding the next step in the evolution of the sector and the technologies produced. However, what is our claim is that the arrival of AI, the arrival is not the case, but the deployment at scale of AI is producing a derailment, or is derailing very strongly, is giving a very big shock to this established way of producing in the industry. And this is why we think it could be also interesting the argument for network of producer, industry, etc. Because here the point is to try to understand how big this shock is and how the industry can be transformed, or a new trajectory being achieved, new rails being started by this AI shock to the chip making industry. This is relevant once again because from this it will depend how our device will be organized, produced, fragmented in terms of which type of hardware will go or will power which type of products, and so on and so forth. So by doing that, we give a contribution, first of all, to this theory of technological trajectories, which is a main aspect of the economics of technological change, where we try to understand for different industries which is the path of rather predictable steps taken by different industries and sector when they innovate. It is also, you will see that we make an argument, we try not to predict, but to derive some scenarios for the industry based on stressing the interrelationship between the software and the hardware industry. And this is sort of what we are going to call the supporting service approach to model the evolution of the industry is taken from the so-called economics of network industries. So it's one approach in which so-called network industries, so industries that are based or that evolve based on the spillover that they receive from their users or connected industries, say this influence their evolution over time. And finally, why we think it's a nice contribution, because it contributes to the so-called theory that is well known in management, in strategy, and also in economics of industry life cycle. So the fact that industries and sector tend to follow some specific, rather predictable in shape, even if not in time horizon, pattern of evolution. Well, this pattern of evolution have to do with the number of firms active in an industry and with the convergence toward a specific, what is called dominant design. So a particular shape or a particular established architectural form of the main product produced in an industry that is then becoming very hard to change. Examples of dominant design are the rectangular shaped smartphone, for example. So it's very hard once this handheld device reach this type of dominant design to break the design, and this then reduce uncertainty, becomes a barrier to entry for new entrant and startup firms, and drive the path of evolution of an industry. So is this going to be the case also for the semiconductor industry? Well, let's see. So as a context or as a rationale, so why we do that, I already told you in a nutshell, is that AI technologies are becoming pervasive. And indeed, the root of everything is digitalization. So the diffusion of the digitization, so the transformation into digital signal and data of many processes that were analog before. And the digitalization process has led to ubiquitous connectivity, ubiquitous computing, and the emergence of new actors, the so-called attention oligopolies. So these few actors like Facebook that monetize out of users' attention. All these transformations have generated troves of data. And therefore, given that more and more actors rely for their working of their business model, for their monetization, or for their, let's say, day-to-day activity on this increasing amount of data, more and more business solutions that are either data-driven or data-intensive are gaining momentum. So there is more and more, as you know, or as you see on every newspaper every day, more and more room, more and more scope for data-intensive solution. Now, given that, given this transformation, the opportunities opened by this data-driven transformation can be reaped by artificial intelligence technology. So AITs are at the center of this transformation because they are the main tool out of which companies, users can reap benefits out of that. However, in order to be able to use artificial intelligence solutions, so software solutions, there is a need to have specific or tailored or matched hardware that, so the computing capacity that is able to perform these AI-driven software solution for to exploit data troves. So there is a software hardware interdependence in the deployment of artificial intelligence. Artificial neural networks as one type, one instantiation of AI technologies are one or the best or the most known or the most diffused nowadays example of this data intensive software solution to exploit the opportunities that the digitalization is bringing to businesses, users, and so on and so forth. And why are they becoming the software, AIT software solution most diffused? It is because artificial neural networks are able to address problems where traditional programming approaches fail. So artificial neural networks are able to deal with non-deterministic problems. They are able to not to solve, but to address the combinatorial explosion that of programming alternatives that standard programming rule-based approaches should have to deal with when trying to cope with an infinite amount of programming alternative to capture the many instances and idiosyncrasies that data troves and the use of that are generating. Standard rule-based programs are too rigid to deal with all these difference and the diversities of context and cases. And in many cases, some problems, for example, natural language processing, computer vision, and prediction of several kinds, in which the problem is a problem of learning and detecting patterns. These are problems that are in nature non-deterministic, so they cannot be solved with deterministic algorithms. So artificial neural network, with being a multi-layer directed network that are a stable structure that adjust as long as data passes through them, so being a sort of distributed topologies, algorithm made as distributed topologies, they are an alternative paradigm to process data and provide solutions. A paradigm that seems to be very much fit with the changing opportunities and problems that are emerging in a world that is increasingly digitized. Now, given that, the research question that we have is that how does then the rise and the diffusion, the widespread, ubiquitous, even though not at scale, but in potential, of artificial neural network in particular and artificial intelligence technologies in general affect the semiconductor industry? Now, the semiconductor industry is characterized by a series of stylized facts or regularities or general information and patterns on which the industry rely. First of all, as I told you, the industry is interesting to study because it has been experiencing since decades a very well-established pattern of development, usually summarized by the so-called Moore law, even though the Moore law is not really a law, it is once again a stylized fact, so an empirical regularity, a pattern that is also decided and agreed upon by the main actors in the industry. So the Moore law as a strategy of miniaturization of elemental component in microchips and another element, which is the capacity races. So the race of producers to produce at scale, at large scale, has been the main way of improving products and producing for the semiconductor industry. Indeed, for example, Intel until 2016, they had the so-called TikTok strategy in which they revised 1 year, they tweaked the architecture of their chips, 1 year they worked on miniaturization, 1 year they worked on architecture, and so on and so forth. So it was very predictable in a world without huge widespread application or potential for artificial neural network that this is how chips are, integrated circuits are improved. Second stylized fact is that there is a stable product variety in a sense that most of the industry produced CPUs, central processing units. There was a niche for the so-called graphical processing units or GPUs, mostly for graphical rendering until 2012, mostly used in the gaming industry. So specialized hardware was really a small niche. There were other niches, of course, especially for supercomputers, but there were not mass production or production at scale. Also, there is a stable set of large players in the industry, Intel, AMD, IBM. So some are more downstream, some are more integrated, some are more on the upstream level of photolithographic equipment production, so Qualcomm, ARM. So there are few actors, it's an oligopoly of actors that know each other. So all the good ingredients for a very predictable development over time of the industry. Now, now we're going to see instead what the arrival of artificial intelligence technologies is producing. How we're going to do that? These are the next steps that I'm going to discuss. So first we're going to look at the software domain. We have to take a very large detour to get to our insights. So first we're going to look, we start from the software domain and the difference among computational approaches and what is happening with artificial neural network, how this reflects in the hardware architecture. And from this we will list the techno-economic forces that then shape the incentives of chip producers to decide how their next product should be shaped, in which direction it should go. And to make the things more formal, we formulated a little model that tried to explain the choices between one system or another in terms of, when I talk about system, I talk about chips, or system on a chips, if you want to be precise, belonging to one or the other paradigm or of computation. Here the title steps toward the answer, not only because it's the several steps that I'm going to follow, but also because it's a quote of the famous paper of 1965, I think, Marvin Minsky, Steps Toward Artificial Intelligence. So in the end of all this story, we will tell you a couple of scenarios that can somehow capture the two trajectories that the industry can take in the next years. So when we talk about computational approaches, so in order to understand what is happening at the hardware, we need to start at the software level. At the very general level of analysis, I told you that artificial neural networks are becoming widespread or becoming more demanded. This is because usually in terms of anybody has to conduct some form of computation, there is a model of computation behind it. So there is a theoretical way in which, or theoretical representation of how this computation is conducted. There are two broad families of models of computation. One is the sequential model of computation, which leads to the so-called control flow programming, in which a stable data there is a set of instructions that on a sequential manner is performed and executed sequentially on a stable data. So each instruction in an algorithm in a virtual machine has a tag of when the data is to be called, performed, analyzed, and then we go to the next instruction, then the next instruction, and so on and so forth. The advantage of the sequential model of computation, it is that it's very powerful in terms of universality. So a Turing machine, which is theoretical model that captured the sequential model of computation, is a conceptual tool that is universal in a sense that can, even though with some theoretical problem, like the stopping problem and so on and so forth, it can perform any type of computation. The only problem of the Turing machine is that sometimes we do not have the idea of the Entscheidungen problem, the stopping problem suggests that we cannot have a proof of a certain algorithm will converge to a solution in a given time or a manageable time. However, this is a universal model of how sequential computation can execute a very heterogeneous set of instructions. Okay? On the other hand, you have another alternative model of computation, so another theoretical approach or paradigm of how computation is conducted, and this is the so-called concurrent model of computation that is an instantiation produced the so-called data flow programming, in which instead of having changing instruction passing through fixed data, you have fixed instruction. For example, a neural network is just a algorithm or a set of instruction that have a very specific structure, fixed structure, and the data passes through that. So This is data flow programming have the property of being easily so more modular, easy to make parallel, so it leads to it's more computationally powerful. However, there is no universal abstraction like the Turing machine for data flow or concurrent program. Why is this important? This is very generic, seems very abstract, but this is important because then these approaches, this paradigm to computation, are embodied into devices. Okay, so the sequential model of computation was transformed into device, was embodied into devices through the so-called von Neumann architecture of chips, in particular of central processing unit or CPU. So this pipeline or sequential model of computation is embodied in some type of microchip and integrated circuits. I use chips and integrated circuits as interchangeable, even though they're not exactly precise. And this type of chips, CPUs that you have in every device that you own, are the sequential model of computation or control flow programming embodied in a physical device. So the physical embodiment of that. GPUs, they are also empirical, physical devices that, however, use as a unit of analysis not scalars as CPUs, so single numbers, but vectors. Vectors are the operation unit of GPUs, but still they rely on control flow architecture, which is the physical architecture that embodies the sequential and control flow model of computation. But there are other types of chips that are embodying the second and different paradigm to computation, the second and different model of computation, which is the concurrent or data flow programming model. And these are the, you might have heard everywhere, these are TPUs, so tensor processing units, and neural network processors, which are matrix or array processors, so the calculation unit, there are matrices or more complex mathematical objects, and or even more parallel in nature are the so-called neuromorphic processors, which are, once again, the embodiment of concurrent computation, even more said because they are kind of analog structure. The signal that is transferred is not a digital signal, but is a analog network of wires. Now, why I tell you that? Because these are all alternatives that the chip makers could produce. However, given the requirement in terms of power needed, energy efficiency, computation, and heterogeneity of program to be solved, chip makers have been focusing mostly, as I told you, on producing control flow architecture, and in particular CPUs, central processing units, these for decades. I can tell you in a second the other scheme that I'm going to tell you. So before artificial neural networks, before the it was made clear that artificial neural networks were able to address data-driven problems in a manner that is very much fit to the concurrent model of computation, or the data flow model of computation, the semiconductor industry converged to control flow architecture, so CPUs. So each chip producer produced CPUs for decades. Because, first, as I told you, it was enough for the set of software that had to be executed. So it was CPUs had enough heterogeneity. They were delivering enough computational power capable to execute the tasks that were needed by users, computer users. And they were energy efficient and powerful enough through one single type of improvement. So producers of chips could focus on one, let's say, innovation lever on how to improve their product, which was miniaturization of components, making transistors smaller and smaller and smaller. Given that, what we call the intensive or the CPU technological trajectory was chosen, even though producers could produce still GPUs or TPU, I mean, they were not really produced at scale, but similar non-scalar processors were viable potentially, theoretically, but not economically viable. Producers focused only on the intensive technological trajectories that suggested to produce only CPUs, the dominant design of chips, at scale. And this strategy was reinforced over time due to the so-called path dependency, so the fact that producers started to do that, and then they saw positive feedback from doing that, and then they could not escape from the advantages of doing that. Also because they had to play the so-called what Steinmuller calls the capacity races. So the fact that in a very strong competition between a few actors, chip producers had to produce very few varieties, CPUs, so they could not experiment with other type of chips. They could, but for example, as I told you, for supercomputers, etc., but not for the wide variety of mass devices, they had to produce quick and at scale. So they prefer scale economies over scope economies. Also because economies of scale, so producing one type of technology at scale, was giving payoffs that were certain, given that it was very predictable, once again, given miniaturization, how to improve the product. This leads us, even though I go backward one slide, to the fact that chip producers, when they decide how to introduce a new product or how to improve existing products, they have to face what we call the techno-economic trilemma. So they have a product, and this product is a chip that delivers a certain computational power, so a certain calculating capabilities. Heterogeneity, so is able to run different types of algorithms, virtual machines, software, instructions, and energy efficiency, which is a form of cost. So it's a form of, especially in miniature contexts, it is important to have energy efficient devices in order to avoid overheating, for example. Now, as I told you, until, let's say, the 2010s, it was clear for producers that CPUs had enough computational power for what was needed to do, business application, users applications, had quite a lot of heterogeneity, in a sense they could run many different, stored programs, von Neumann architecture chips, they could run a huge variety of software and instructions, and they were relatively energy efficient. The decision to focus on CPUs was once again because of the ease of just so the Moore law is exactly that, miniaturizing transistors. So one move allowed producers to improve in computational power and improve in energy efficiency at the same time. So it goes without saying that alternative models of computation and alternative devices embodying this model of computation were not regarded as viable. Now, what is happening now is that, first of all, the Moore law is reaching for the current generations of chips, some form of limit, even though the producers are trying to overcome this, in a sense that energy efficiency reach boundaries because of energy leakage problems, heating gap problems, and so on and so forth. And second, as the whole premise of this presentation, the booming of data troves made the requirement of computational power much more stringent, made that a very strong constraint or a very demanding requirement for users of computing devices. Hence, that open up room to experiment with new products. Indeed, given the rise of artificial neural network and the data related and connected with them, so large unstructured data set, artificial neural network proved to be very useful and very efficient for a set of tasks where traditional program fails. Why I say 2012 as a, not starting point, but as a breakthrough point for this dynamics, because this was the result of ImageNet competition in which the AlexNet algorithm was a neural network working with GPUs, NVIDIA GPUs. So it became clear that this type of hardware, which was relegated to very small niche, given all the economic incentive of producers to focus on CPUs, when CPUs fell short of capability of solving new tasks, like feature recognitions in recognition in visual task and image recognition task and all the others that now we know for with AI, producers found out that actually this is a market this enlarged. With this awareness, what was a very specific technological trajectory is we produce CPUs, we miniaturize CPUs, the rest is for gaming, just small niches. This was led to a very strong derailment. Producers started to are now in the in a very uncertain phase in which they their standard way of doing business of chip production is contested in a sense that they have to think much more with much more attention to this trilemma, meaning that they want for the new application that the AI brings with itself, much more computational power is needed. However, so if you need to let's say solve a computational demanding task, you might want to use TPUs, neuromorphic chips, or a set of GPUs. However, especially TPUs, they are devices that rely on an alternative model of computation. So this means rethinking the whole theoretical basis that producers have taken as granted. And if they start to jump on these other products to be produced in mass, these products like TPUs, they are very non-heterogeneous, so they are able to address only a very specific set of problems, not like CPUs. Okay, so in this trilemma that you see in front of you, if you want to push the frontier of computational power high, you will have to give up as a trade-off heterogeneity. If you want to have instead systems that are both powerful and heterogeneous, this might have backdrops on energy efficiency, and so on and so forth. This finally, when we developed that, putting together several pieces of the theory, then we checked the last year, 2019 Hot Chips Conference, which is the main conference of chip producers, and the CEO of AMD presented a picture that was very, very similar to that, in which they compared specialized or application-specific integrated circuit or ASICs, CPUs, and GPGPUs, which are general-purpose graphic processing units, which are GPUs that are orchestrated by a CPU. If you check our paper, which I will link in the chat later on, you will see we reproduce that. So this is something that the industry is really discussing now. So what is the industry doing? There is a huge set of strategies that are now increasing the uncertainty in the industry, because producer can decide. So this is the typical crossroad when some innovator firms jump on the new paradigm, the distributed or concurrent model of computation, and they change radically the philosophy behind their products, while others try to tweak their existing product, and other they still have to decide. So for example, if you look at what is happening in the semiconductor industry, producers are experimenting with, first of all, they are trying to change architecture. So they are trying to make more TPUs, for example, or GPUs, or combinations of. They are launching neuromorphic chips more and more. This is also interestingly done by a joint venture of standard producers with digital giants. So there is the Facebook and Intel, there is the Amazon and another producer. So which somehow also suggests, as economists pointed out already, that there are market structure and industrial organization effect of the arrival of AI. But what they are doing mostly, they are experimenting with design features, which means they are experimenting with materials. So for example, should I produce TPUs or should I still produce GPUs, but made of graphene rather than silicon buffer? Should I do like Cerebras is doing, the now company very much on the media, to increase the buffer size rather than changing other underlying principles? Should the company experiment signal type? So instead of electric signal or so electronic signals, to use laser or optical signals? Should we continue to work with CPUs but experiment in interconnect, like for example, placing memories directly next to the computing units, or redesigning the bus, so the connectivity between, for example, memories or different parts of the system on a chip? Or should we place and do, should we place the elements one above the other and do 3D or die stacking? So should we work on packaging on the chips rather than switch to the new paradigm? So these are very strong incentive problems. If you are not yet convinced, this is a we checked patent data, and the fact that producers and innovators are starting to, so this is an indicator that producers are not confused, but there is strong uncertainty on where to allocate resources. And these are costly experiments to do. So these are, for example, international patent classification codes for two classes, the G06 and 302, are, which is the exponential increasing curve. These are computing devices based on neural network models, so which are exactly chips based on concurrent model of computation. And compared to the other line, which is the one with the little triangles, which are knowledge-based model, which is a hardware that embodies, for example, expert systems, which is stagnant, you see that there is much more exploration and innovation in these new devices. So you have on the one hand, a lot of innovation in shifting the industry to the new paradigm. On the other, you have a lot of levers to act on different elements of design and architecture in order to keep the trajectory as it is. Now, to understand how the things can go, we model the industry in a very simple way. And I don't know, maybe this can result boring, so I will just go very quick, and in case we can return during the question. What we model is a very simple choice model in which we have a continuum of users that can decide if to, I don't know if you see my cursor moving, but they can decide between one system C and one system G, where, for example, C is a CPU or a control flow embedding device, and G is a GPU, which is not really a concurrent model of computation embedding device, but something like that. And users have a utility if they buy one system or another system, where this utility is V for both system, and this V is somehow, we try to capture and to model, to formalize this trilemma. So the V, so the value that each chip under each alternative paradigm of computation brings, can be modeled as E times S, where E is an indicator of efficiency. And if you want, we define efficiency as operation per second divided watt per second, where operation per second is power and watt per second is energy efficiency. So these are two corners of the trilemma that we described. And S are the, as the amount of software that can be run on this chip, labeled C, which is the other corner of the trilemma, which is the heterogeneity. We split the big software pool that can be run on this chip C in two parts, which is the SC small, which is the amount of software written for this chip, so standard program written for CPUs, for example, plus a certain element raw times C, times, sorry, S, G, where G is the other alternative device embedding a different model of computation. And these are software, for example, this could be, while SC could be Excel or a software that is well run in CPU-based for CPU-based computation devices. SG could be a imager visual recognition software, software for an automated or self-driving car. The raw is a sort of opportunity cost or rate of transformation or possibility to, through some cost, run the software written for another system on the first system. It is, you should imagine this raw as the capability of when you want to run a software for Windows on your Mac, what do? You use a emulator. Okay, the raw is like an emulator. It would be the emulator to run software written for neural network processors on CPUs. Less efficient with more time, but in some way. So both system C and G, they have this value. And our point is to find when it is the optimal choice between these two systems. How do we do that? We have the supply side, so consumers will choose based on the utility is based on the value is based on the trilemma that we defined. Producers try to maximize their profits, where this their pie are the profits for producer producing system C or system G. And then if you solve it, in a sense, if you equate the two utility, you can find the optimal price that the two producer, the producers can charge for one system or another, which also define which is the optimal split, which is the last equation here of the X bar is the optimal split of the market between users that buy the CPU and users that buy the GPU or the TPU. And this split of the market is depending on the difference in values and on this lambda, which is this utility that the users have when they adopt a system that is not doing exactly what they wanted. And what we did a little bit of static, comparative statics, so analysis of how the main element that decides how the market is split between systems or the difference in values that these chips gives to the users change when some variables are changed. And here some variable I did not describe, for example, K is the how much the AI-related chip is more computational efficient than the CPU. But anyway, the point is that the difference between the two systems decreases if more software is written for the, let's say, AI chip, or if it is easier to transform the standard software in AI software, so it's easy to emulate one or the other, or the values of CPUs increases if it is easier to translate software written for AI devices in CPU style. If you think about this, it's very stylized, but these rows, for example, you can imagine that these are the availability of cross-platforms programming environment. So if you think about TensorFlow or Caffe, so these are programming environments through which Google or Facebook help programmers that program for AI chips to transform in AI logic also standard programs. So this would be the raw G. So the better TensorFlow gets, if you want, the less is the difference in value between CPUs and TPUs. And this value can even become negative, meaning that TPUs become more efficient or more demanded. So somehow these are all the elements put together in a formalized way. Now, when you factor in all these elements, all these techno-economic forces that pushes producers to change or not to change what they're going to do in their chip-making production processes, given the arrival of and the diffusion of AI, we summarize that in two scenarios. Scenarios number one would be one in which our model somehow suggests that the market is very fragmented and split. And this is what also other scholars suggest, that the industry will fragment. The industry will fragment and will stop to produce or will stop to improve CPUs because there is high value in producing application specific integrated circuit, each one different for every AI market, if you want. Chip for visual or image recognition, chips for neural language processing, chips for automated vehicles, and so on and so forth. So what is this scenario? This is the scenario in which the shock of AI eating chip making sector leads to a transformation of the sector in a fragmented manner. The other alternative scenario is the one in which AI has been given a shock to the system that had a dominant design, CPUs. This has derailed the trajectory, but the trajectory will now reconverge toward new dominant design, which we dubbed platform chips, where platform chips will be chips universally applicable to many uses and all including heterogeneous core and modular systems inside. So you can have that the industry can either fragment, so not to return anymore to a stable trajectory which reduces uncertainty and having many sub-trajectory, or to return with the new dominating product to a new trajectory, let's say a new stable trajectory. This depends very much on what I was telling you before. This is the set of programs or software that can be produced by or run by chips that are rule-based or let's say standard like CPUs, and by the others that are non-deterministic like AI chips. And the way in which the outer part, which is all the new software, computer vision, robot orientation, is eating up the original programs. So how it will be easier to recode software and instruction for new chips, the easier that will be, the more pervasive will become the AI related chips. And this then can lead, depending on how much new type of approaches will eat up the set of software already existing, can lead to one of the scenario or the other. So to conclude, the big transformation, the digitalization, unstructured data, etc., has brought to the fore may benefit from new chips. New chips exist since a long time, but have not been produced at scale because producers had a very strong incentive to continue the momentum of production on a very precise technological trajectories, which was the one of von Neumann sequential production embodied in CPUs. This because of scale, preferring scale over scope. The arrival of AI is giving a shock to this technological trajectory. This is open up new experimentation and a lot of uncertainty with the industry that now has to deal with the trilemma that we highlighted. They have to decide if to produce new product, if to shift paradigm or continue on the existing one by tweaking it in order to solve a set of problems that have to do with increasing requirement for computational power, need for heterogeneity of computation, so capability to run different software, and so multi-homing, if you want, of software, and energy efficiency. This, together with the market structure, the sunk cost, the scale economies, so a lot of techno-economic drivers, and the capability to interchange software given the strategic choices to have, for example, programming platforms and environment, will lead to either of the two of the outcome for the industry, the breaking up completely of the technological trajectory and the fragmentation of the industry, or the jumping on the of a new trajectory that we suggest is the one of platform chip. We would bet on the second. And I can tell you that there is a couple of evidence that can be used in this direction. For example, the news of yesterday is that NVIDIA is acquiring ARM, so the UK producer of mostly edge chip architecture, so chips for mobile devices, etc., is going to be acquired by NVIDIA, that realized that most likely is not able to deflect completely the technological trajectory with GPUs, so they try to consolidate, and most likely this might lead to coordination toward the possibility to insert in a chip system or platform chip different units that are modular. And also it is the news of a couple of days ago, that, for example, the Myriad 2 chip of Intel, that was an application-specific chip for visual image recognition. It was mostly used in drones. Now it's experimented at CERN and at the European Space Agency in order to be sent on space, which somehow suggests exactly the type of software and the type of instruction that this chip will have to deal with is larger, or is going to be larger. So it's expanding the set of software, which means that it might include new modules, new type of function, and hence tends toward a more platform-like chip. So I would, I hope this was interesting. I look forward to your question, and I thank you in advance for your attention. Here are our addresses, and I will also link the paper in the chat.